Welcome everyone to this video on the calorimetry and Hess's law experiment. Here we will discuss how to measure delta H, the change of enthalpy, using a coffee cup calorimeter. In addition, we want to use Hess's law to determine the enthalpy of a combustion reaction. Let's start by reviewing why we measure delta H. There are two information we get from delta H. One is that the value of delta H tells us the relative strengths of chemical bonds of the reactants and products. On a more practical level, delta H tells us how much energy a reaction needs to run, if it's an endothermic reaction, or how much energy the reaction produces if it's an exothermic reaction. As a result, determining delta H values for chemical reactions is one of the most critical experiments to do. Today, we will determine the delta H for a metal combustion reaction. The reaction looks like the following. A metal, M, reacts with oxygen to form MXOY, which is a metal oxide. The X and Y values depend on the type of metal that we're using. Now, the delta H of a combustion reaction is usually measured in an instrument called a bomb calorimeter, but we don't have that instrument. So we're going to have to come up with an alternative method. As you may recall, in thermochemistry, we learned that if we cannot measure the delta H of a reaction directly, we can use the concept of Hess's law to determine the delta H. Hess's law refers to the idea that the delta H of a reaction can be measured indirectly by finding other reactions that add up to give the reaction of interest. The example is shown schematically here. Let's say you have a reaction A goes to B that you want to measure the delta H of, which in this case is called delta H1. However, for some reason, you can't measure it directly. As long as you can find some other reactions that add up to give A goes to B, the sum of the delta H of those reactions will be equal to delta H1. For example, let's say there's a reaction A goes to C with delta H equals to delta H2, and another reaction C goes to B with delta H equals to delta H3. As it's shown here, adding the two reactions cancel out C, and then resulting in the reaction of A goes to B, which is what we're looking for. That means the sum of the two delta H's, delta H2 and 3, is equal to delta H1 in this case. So for today's reaction, our target is the combustion reaction that I was showing you earlier. It turns out that we can use the following three reactions to find our delta H of combustion. The three reactions are a reaction between a metal, M, with HCl to produce a metal chloride and hydrogen gas. The delta H of this reaction will be measured experimentally using a coffee cup calorimeter. We also need a second reaction, which is a reaction between a metal oxide, MXOY, with HCl to produce metal chloride and water. This delta H will also be measured using a coffee cup calorimeter. Lastly, we will need a reaction called the formation reaction of water, which is shown here. The value of delta H for this reaction is called the standard molar enthalpy of formation and can be obtained in a thermodynamic reference table like the one we use in lecture. So let's discuss how we obtain the experimental values of delta H using the coffee cup calorimeter. In other words, the values of delta H1 and 2. Recall from our lecture that in a coffee cup calorimeter, you can measure the amount of heat under constant pressure that accompanies a chemical reaction. The heat you measure is the heat of surroundings, given the symbol Q of surroundings here, and it can be found by multiplying the mass of the reaction mixture by its specific heat capacity and the change in temperature that occurs during the reaction. Now, to get the delta H of a reaction, simply take the negative of the Q of surroundings, since the reaction is the system in this case. Let's see how we actually do this. So in this example, we mix 1.104 grams of iron with 26.023 grams of HCl in a coffee cup calorimeter. We found the temperature increases. We were told to use the specific heat of water as the specific heat of the solution and to calculate the delta H for the balance reaction equation. Note that the final unit of the delta H must be in kilojoules per mole of reaction. This is a common unit in thermochemistry and it refers to the amount of energy transferred for a given balance chemical equation. So let's first start with writing that balance equation, which should look like the following between iron and HCl. Now, to calculate the heat of the surroundings, we're going to add the mass of the metal and HCl. That gives us the total mass of the reaction mixture, and then multiply that by the specific heat, and then delta T, which is given here, and that all ends up giving us 942.04475 joules. As I said earlier, the actual value of the delta H will be the negative of the Q of the surrounding, so it will be negative -942.04475 joules. Now, question is, how do we convert that to units of kilojoules per mole of reaction? You're going to have to go through several steps. First, the value that we just have is the heat generated by a certain quantity of the limiting reactant in our reaction. We were told in the questions that iron is the limiting reactant. So that means that the -942 comes from 1.104 grams of iron. Now, this can be converted to per mole of iron if we were to multiply that with the molar mass of iron. If we stop here, we will get kilojoules per mole of iron. But you see that in your balance equation, you actually have 2 moles of iron. So to convert our unit to per mole of reaction, we're going to have to do one more step, which is multiplying what we have earlier with 2 moles of iron per mole of reaction. So our final answer ends up being -94.69 kilojoules per mole of reaction. So that's how you will calculate the experimental delta H from your coffee cup calorimeter data. Let's now do another example to show you what you will need to do to get your enthalpy of combustion once you have all 3 delta H values. So here you have your experimental values. They're labeled delta HA and delta HB for the metal and metal oxide reaction. In your actual reaction, of course, these will be numbers. Then you also obtain a value for the standard molar enthalpy of formation for water, which here we call delta HC. The question asks you to calculate the combustion enthalpy of iron to form iron oxide, which is given right here. This requires us to manipulate the given reactions and add them to give our target reaction. We can get there if we do the following. First, multiply reaction 1 by 2, which gives us this equation, and its delta H now is double the previous value. We also have to reverse reaction 2 and multiply that by 2, which gives us this reaction with delta H being equal to delta HB multiplied by -2. Then we have the last reaction, which we have to multiply by 6, and that gives us this reaction with its delta H being equal to 6 times delta HC. If you add these 3 reactions together and cancel out some of the species that are identical, you will get our target combustion reaction. So that means the value of our delta H of combustion comes from adding 2 times delta HA minus 2 times delta HB plus 6 times delta HC. So that's how you will carry out the calculations in today's lab. Let's now look at the actual experimental steps. Most of the steps in your lab manual are correct, but there are slight changes which I will describe below. First, instead of 3 metal-metal oxide combination, as described in your lab manual, you're only going to have 2. So each group can work either with magnesium-magnesium oxide combination or zinc-zinc oxide combination. You're going to be assigned the specific combination in lab. Very importantly, the concentration of HCl you would have to use depends on the metal-metal oxide combination. As you can see, you only need a 1 molar HCl for the magnesium-magnesium oxide combination, while you will need a 6 molar HCl for the zinc-zinc oxide combination. The bottles of HCl with the 2 concentrations are shown here to make sure that you don't confuse them. You should set up your calorimeter as follows. Put 1 styrofoam cup into another one to provide insulation for the heat and get a lid for the cup. The lid should have 2 holes in it to insert a thermometer and a stirring rod. Lastly, you want to get a beaker that allows the cup to fit snugly. The beaker will prevent the cup from tipping over and spilling the content of the reaction. First, you should add the correct volume of HCl into the cup and then measure its mass and temperature. This is going to be your initial temperature. Then you want to add the solid into the HCl, so either the metal or the metal oxide. Close the lid immediately and then start stirring. Observe the temperature, it should start rising. Record the maximum temperature you observe in your experiment. Then repeat the experiment with other samples. In total, there should be 4 measurements. You will do 2 repeats with the metal and 2 with the metal oxide. The data will be recorded in your lab report as you see here. On the left is 2 trials for the metal and on the right for the metal oxide. Let's finish by discussing some safety procedure. The lab requires you to use your standard PPE and gloves to handle HCl. Once you finish the experiment, discard all the reagents in the hazardous waste container. When you're done with the experiments, rinse and dry the styrofoam cups and the lid, and then put them back in a box on the instructor bench. Okay, that wraps up the discussion on this lab. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in lab.